Hello, everyone, and then welcome to another session of the WAIMM webinar series. Mineral exploration drilling is a very intensive, extensive, and very expensive venture. In fact, sometimes it runs into tens, hundreds, and in most cases, millions of US dollars for an extensive program. The success and otherwise of a mining project actually depends on a good drilling campaign. But there's a problem. If the right and necessary protocols are not adhered to, we end up getting bad data and lose big time money. With us today to share some thoughts on the necessary protocols and QC sampling techniques during mineral exploration drilling is Seraphina Alomeney. Seraphina is a geologist at Kinross Chirano mine. She's also a WAIMM Young Professional member. My name is Lawrence Omarimens, I'm the president of WAIMM. And then I'm going to be your host for today. Back, relax, and enjoy the session as always. Thank you very much for making it to us today.
Good afternoon once again, and thank you, Mr. Omari, for as well as the executives of WAIMM for giving me the opportunity to share the little knowledge I have acquired in the industry. I also want to acknowledge that we have very experienced industry professionals in attendance today, and their comments and contributions are warmly welcome. For the purpose of this presentation, we'll look at some exploration sampling techniques. We'll look at how to optimize these procedures, especially core and RC drilling. We'll look at some sources of error. We'll look at QAQC protocols, how to get sampling and QAQC right. We'll also look at how to marry the two processes for an optimal exploration program. We'll take comments and questions from members, and it is my hope that by the end of the presentation, we'll have shared some beautiful ideas on the topic. As we may all be aware, the value of every mining company is typically based on its reserves and resources. Reserves and resources are derived from an asset database after sampling, particularly RC and diamond drilling. An error-free database gives confidence to the investor, and it also protects shareholder value. It also reduces risk on project feasibility and economics, as well as on mergers and acquisition. Now, in order to be listed on any international stock market, it is important that your reporting will conform to statutory reporting requirements worldwide. And a good and healthy database also gives much credibility to the reputation of the company, and it also helps avoid unnecessary lawsuits, which all start from sampling. Now, for any one method of sampling, there are many variations that have been designed to suit a particular exploration program. Each method has its own advantages as well as disadvantages, and also characteristic sources of error that may come about from applying a particular technique to a particular type of mineralization. Typical types of sampling methods include stream and soil geochemical sampling, which is done regionally to help us find anomalies and focus in on smaller areas. It is also done locally to focus in on surface anomalies of elements or pathfinder elements that are associated with the mineralization. So the picture at the top right shows geologists taking soil samples. For soil sampling, the vegetation would have to be removed from at least 1.5 meters away from the sampling point because we do not want a lot of tree roots coming into the sample. The sample will also have to be representative enough, at least weigh about 2 to 3 kilograms. Another type of typical exploration sampling is the trench sampling. It is normally undertaken after surface sampling, and samples from trenching is taken deeper in the soil horizon or in the regolith profile, as can be seen in the picture at the bottom right. Now, these two techniques are done at the prospecting stage and may normally not influence on your reserve and resource estimation process. However, these are processes that you may have to complete in order for you to move to the next stage of exploration. Drilling is the main focus of this presentation. Now, drilling is normally carried out at advanced stage of exploration. It is done when a geologist is confident of a target, and we may also infill details that is necessary for resource estimation. Typical types of drilling include RC drilling, which produces chips, as can be seen in the picture on the top right. These chips are for logging purposes. Another type is diamond drilling, which produces core, as can be seen on the picture at the bottom right. Drilling is a very expensive venture, as Mr. Omari has already said, and so there's a need for us to optimize sampling. There's a need for us to put processes in place for us to get value for money. How do we optimize RC sampling? We first of all, we have to accurately survey our drill hole color. We have to also ensure that we take downhole survey at reasonable depth, and as much as possible that the downhole surveys are accurate. Now, there may be challenges in controlling the hole deviation, as contractor drillers will always want to rush to get their meters. However, measures have to be put in place to, as much as possible, stabilize the hole so that it does not deviate so much from your target. It is important that all samples that are collected from the cyclone are weighed. This is to give us an accurate recovery of our samples. The record from the recovery has to be well documented. Now, it is also very important to split the samples with a good quality splitter. An example of which is a 50-50 Jones type rifle splitter that can be seen on the picture at the top right. During splitting, it is necessary to ensure that as much as possible, we do not spill the sample. Spilling will cause bias in our sampling. It will also mean that we are losing some of our gold. It is also very important that the rifle splitter is cleaned, preferably after every sample has been split. The whole idea or purpose for splitting our RC sample is so that we homogenize the sample and so that we send a representative unbiased sample to the lab for testing. Now, a typical RC sample, if for instance, 1 meter weighs approximately 36 kilograms, will be split into two samples weighing 18 kilograms each. One of the sample will be kept as the weak reject, where the other one will be further split into two samples of 9 kilograms. One of the sample will be sent to the lab for analysis. The other may also be sent as a duplicate sample. Otherwise, it will be added to the rig reject. Now, it is also very important to note that the weight of the RC samples is not fixed. We can have different weights in the oxides. We can have the weights being different in the transition material, the weights may also be different in the fresh rock samples. Also, it is important to note that lithology can also influence the weights of the samples. One major disadvantage of the RC sampling is that the samples cannot be taken accurately with respect to any form of geological boundaries or contact. Diamond drilling is particularly valuable where samples have to be taken within strict geological limits. Factors such as geology, the structure, or alteration influence how a diamond core will be sampled. How do we optimize diamond drill sampling? Just like in the RC, we have to ensure that we accurately survey our drill hole color. We have to make sure that our downhole surveys are done at reasonable intervals. We need to control the hole deviation. One important thing we also need to look at is our sample recovery. We need to, as much as possible, ensure that we record the recovery, and also we need to compare it to the driller's meters that are recovered. Now, we also have to be keen on core losses as well as core grinding. This is because they introduce bias in your sampling, and also because once the core is lost, you cannot log it. You cannot log what you do not see. Also, the diamond drill core has to be logged extensively because all of the factors or data that you capture will in turn influence how you will sample your core. So in the picture at the top right, we can see diamond drill core, which has been marked for cutting and sampling. You can see that consistently the geologist has marked the core at an interval of 1 meter. This is because the geologist thinks that the rock type or lithology is the same. He also thinks that the alteration is the same, and perhaps even the pyrite distribution in the core is the same. So for an instance where we have maybe from here to here being a different rock type or a different lithology, then the geologist will sample or mark this part out of the other interval. It is also important for us to look at how our core is cut. Our core needs to be cut perpendicularly to the orientation line or the structures that are present in the core. This will prevent any form of bias and also improve precision. The core cutting machine must also preferably be the automated type, because for the automated type, it ensures that our samples are cut into two exact halves instead of the manual type where the technician has to push the core. And so if the technician is afraid of cutting his hand, then the core cut will be skewed. So the picture at the bottom right shows an automated type of core cutting machine. You can see a diamond core sitting in the core guide. That will be propelled to the blade with the help of the chain. This type of core cutting machine is also very safe and will ensure that you get to exact halves of the core. It is also very important that measures are put in place to clean the core guide as much as possible so that it prevents any form of carry over contamination. There are various ways by which error can be introduced into a sampling process. Now, data entry errors can also come about when we have errors such as coordinate errors that come from reversing either the northing and eastern coordinates or the eastern and elevation coordinates. It can also come about when we miss or omit any of the digits, as can be seen here. So here we can see that instead of 5 digits for the eastern coordinates, we are seeing 4. And also down here, we can see that our northern and eastern coordinates have been interchanged. This will cause our data to plot as outliers, as in the second picture here. Data entry errors can also come about when field data is logged inconsistently. So for instance, for a certain type of rock type, you log it today as a dolerite, then tomorrow you want to log it as a tonalite. It will make you misinterpret your data that you have captured or the sampling that you have made at the end of the day. In optimizing our sampling and making sure that our database is error-free, one important aspect that we have to look at is our quality assurance and quality control. Now, what is quality assurance? Quality assurance is a set of procedures and protocols that are in place to assure consistent and accurate results. It returns confidence in the procedures. Quality control is a data and analysis generated during a program that validates the sampling and assaying procedures followed. Quality control returns confidence in results. So we can see that quality assurance speaks to your procedures. It has to do with the systems that you have put in place. What protocols, what procedures are you following? Whereas the control speaks to the results that you get at the end of your sampling program. Quality assurance systems are also known as quality management systems, and they are mostly based on four key pillars, which is to define, measure, analyze, and then improve. Adapting it to mineral exploration, we will first of all need to define our sampling protocols. What sampling method are we using in the first place? How are we going to sample our RC samples or our drill core samples? What analytical methods are we using to analyze our samples? Is it fire assaying? Is it aqua regia? What field controls are we putting in place to ensure that our samples are collected correctly? And also, how do we train the personnel that will undertake the sampling task? We also need to monitor the chain of custody of our samples right from the collection point through to when we receive results from the lab. What laboratory controls are in place to make sure that we receive the accurate result? Also, what quality control protocols have we put in place to help us know how well our results are coming out? How often do we even audit the labs to make sure that they are doing the right things? Also, we need to analyze the results and QC data that we receive from the lab and also put in corrective action for results that report outside of acceptable limits. We also have to improve by giving feedback to the lab in case something goes wrong, which will be evident in the results, or whether we have to retrain our personnel who undertake the sampling test. So this process is an unending cycle. It gives us the opportunity to always improve upon our systems as well as to help us to get accurate, reliable results. Why is QAQC even necessary at all? Quality assurance is necessary to reduce or manage error. It also enhances value, and it also helps us to preserve shareholder value. Whereas quality control procedures are necessary to monitor how accurate our results are, how precise they are, or whether or not we have foreign material coming in. So as we can still see, quality assurance still speaks to the procedures and protocols, whereas quality control deals with our results. Field controls are important parameters that are used to manage or verify procedures and results that we get. Field control samples include standards. Standards are reference materials that have a known concentration of the desired elements, in our case, gold. Standards are used to monitor accuracy, they are used to monitor bias, and they are also used to monitor systematic trends over time. Now, how do we even know whether a standard is of good quality and can be used? A standard that is of good quality must have its matrix identical to the matrix of the samples that are being analyzed. A good standard should have an extremely low homogeneity. A good standard should have grade that is within the all grade range. A good standard must also be reliably prepared and accurately characterized. Field blanks are also control samples, and then they help, they are samples that contain negligible or insignificant amount of gold. They help us to monitor contamination and also monitor missequencing of samples during preparation and analysis. Field blanks must undergo the same analysis procedures as the regular samples. And also field blanks must not be stored close to or near samples that contain gold. This is because we do not want them to be contaminated even before they get to the lab. Field duplicates are used to check precision. And so the results from field duplicates must not be used to fail or pass a batch, as they only tell us how accurate our sampling or sub-sampling protocols are. Okay. So poor precision that is got from the results of field duplicates should only help us to go back and look at our sampling protocols and put in corrective measures. So here are some quality control checklists that we have to look at to make sure that we our sampling process is right and that QAQC is followed as per best practice. In monitoring of accuracy, were standards inserted in the batch? If so, how many standards were inserted in the batch? And what was the frequency of insertion? How was the standard even prepared? And was the standard blind to the lab's eye, or the technician forgot to remove the label from the standard, and so the lab can tell which standard it is? Also, what actions were taken for standards that reported value outside of acceptable limits? In monitoring of contamination, were blank samples inserted in the batch? What was the frequency of insertion? How were the blank samples prepared? Where were the blank samples stored prior to analysis? And what actions were taken after received results and the blank samples reported value outside of acceptable limits? In monitoring of precision, we look at how the duplicates were prepared, whether or not the duplicates were even taken, and how the frequency of insertion into a batch is. We also have to look at what actions were taken for duplicates that reported value outside of acceptable limits. Analytical methods. What laboratory is analyzing your sample? What analysis procedures are in place? What analysis methods? What quality control are the laboratories putting in place to ensure that you have less contamination, to ensure that your results are accurate and they are precise? Chain of custody. How do we monitor how our samples are collected, how the samples are examined, how the samples are analyzed at the lab, and even how we receive results from the lab? Do we receive results via text messages? Do we receive results via phone calls? What systems are in place to ensure that the reporting system is statutory and as required? For geological control, how do we merge the results that we have received from the lab with our log or the data that we have collected from logging the samples? Have we plotted the result on bias chart that will help us decide on what to do? And then also, how do we make sure that the lab is giving us accurate, precise, and reliable results? Is the lab always to be blamed? Naturally, as geologists, we want to pin any smallest mistake on the lab, but a large proportion of errors are self-inflicted. Errors that geologists can make include sample numbering mistakes, insertion of wrong standards, sample switches, data entry error, for instance, where you cut and paste instead of actual typing, or even when you're typing, omitting some of your sample numbers, or also using substandard databases, and also inserting incompatible standards whose metrics do not match with the other samples that are being analyzed. That is not to say that the lab cannot also make mistakes. The lab can also make sampling numbering mistakes. The lab can also switch our samples. You may have contamination from the lab resulting from poor cleaning practices. The lab may have substandard calibration of their instruments and pipettes. You may have temperature fluxes that will be as a result of hot plate issues, or all of those kind of mistakes are those that the lab can make. Now, there are implications of poor quality control programs for resource estimation. Poor quality control may lead to grade overestimation or grade underestimation. It affects the resource tonnage, grade, and classification. It also affects project feasibility. It just means that when you have poor quality control practices, you may even overlook or walk over high grade deposits because your controls in the first place are wrong. So even when it's the results are supposed to report high grade, they'll end up reporting low grade, and you sweep those projects or programs under the carpet instead of chasing them. So poor quality control programs are very important so that we do not miss or lose sight of our deposits. How do we get our sampling and QAQC right? We need to start by digitally capturing our field data. This means that primary data has to be captured on the field. It removes any form of ambiguity from leaving the field and then getting to the office. It prompts the geologist to enter the required data using preferred codes. It also validates the data upon entering it, and it enforces consistency. Now, there should also be a system to automatically generate sample numbers and quality control position. Some geological databases help to do this. There should be a proper design of sampling strategies that we will have to follow to ensure that our sampling is done correctly. We would also have to make sure that we train the personnel that will undertake the sampling task so that they understand these strategies and systems in order for them to implement them correctly. It is also very important to continuously supervise the personnel as they are doing the task. This will ensure that they do the right things in the field, because you can sit in the office thinking that they are doing the right thing only for you to get to the field and realize that because sometimes they are tired, they don't split the RC correctly, or even for diamond core, instead of splitting, they prefer to use a hammer to just break the sample off, which will cause fire. So supervision is very, very important. In conclusion, sampling techniques and QAQC protocols are not procedures that have to stand alone. They must be well integrated for us to attain optimality in our exploration program.